Hello, ma'am. I have a lot of slides, but I don't think it will take a long time. So we discussed last time how there has been a change in the diagnosis and definition of myeloma defining events, where other than the presence of bone marrow plasma cells or an extramedullary plasmacytoma, in the past we needed the CRAB criteria to be fulfilled, but now we have the SLIM criteria also. So where even if you don't have an end organ damage, if you fulfill these criteria of increased bone marrow plasma cells or an increase in FLC ratio or more than one focal lesion in the MRI, you're still defined as having a multiple myeloma. Then we spoke about the revised ISS staging, where in addition, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible. Yeah.
So the revised ISS staging, where in addition to the beta 2 microglobulin and albumin, we have also now included LDH levels and cytogenetics. And that 97% of patients with multiple myeloma have some abnormality, some cytogenetic abnormality. And now we are risk stratifying patients into standard risk and high risk myelomas based on the type of cytogenetic abnormality that they have. So myeloma treatment had been slow for a long
time. Ma'am, you're not audible.
For myeloma, where even in the absence of end organ damage, with the SLIM criteria, patients still are diagnosed as having myeloma. We spoke last time about the revised ISS staging, where we are including the LDH and cytogenetic abnormalities. We discussed how patients with myeloma, almost all of them have some cytogenetic abnormality. And based on this, we are sending now for all patients the FISH panel for myeloma, where we are able to divide them into standard risk and high risk categories. And the difference is that patients with standard risk myeloma with the current therapies that are seeing cells longer than 10 to 12 years, but high risk myelomas even now remain challenging with survivals only in the range of 3 years. So I think sending patients the FISH stratification is very important, so that we know how aggressive we have to be with the treatment. So like I said, for a long time, there wasn't much happening in myeloma other than steroids, melphalan, and the role of transplant in the 80s and 90s of last century. But now we have this explosion of drugs in myeloma. Even in the older classes like proteasome inhibitors and IMiDs, we are seeing new medications like carfilzomib, ixazomib, lenalidomide, and pomalidomide in the IMiDs. So more active agents in each class, and also a lot of novel agents are there. We will also be talking about BCMA targeted therapy, which is right now, I think, the new kid on the block and the buzzword in myeloma. So we'll discuss about that a little bit. But coming back to the nitty-gritties, when we have so many medications available, and we have a patient who is diagnosed with myeloma, what do we do? So the first thing we have to decide in our mind is the patient transplant eligible or not? And in our country, I think transplant eligible also includes transplant affordable. But we definitely have to see if the patient is fit for getting a transplant or not. For both the eligible and ineligible treatments, we have the induction therapy, where we give a combination of medications, try and get a maximum response. We also have to try and get a fast control of the disease, because many times patients come with renal insufficiency, hypercalcemias, anemia, a lot of bone pain. So it's The goal of the induction therapy is to bring a good control of the disease. And at the same time, we want to have minimal toxicity to our patients and allow for adequate stem cell harvesting. So if a patient is eligible for a transplant, we don't want to give an induction therapy that will compromise on getting enough stem cells. So we should be avoiding prolonged use of lenalidomide or daratumumab and avoid melphalan-based therapies. So first decision is to give a good induction, get the disease under control, and also decide whether this patient is eligible for a transplant or not. So these are some of the older trials which were patients who were not eligible for transplant. We use this one is bortezomib, melphalan and prednisone, the VISTA trial. And it is the first trial where we showed that having a continuous treatment with lenalidomide dexamethasone was much better than having a shortened treatment of 18 months. So based on these studies, for many patients in the past, we used to give either a double drug regimen of lenalidomide dexamethasone. Some patients we would give bortezomib dexamethasone, and in transplant ineligible patients, the combination of bortezomib, melphalan and prednisone also we saw good improvements in progression-free survival and overall survival. So how do we build up from this point? And for currently, when we see a patient with newly diagnosed multiple myeloma, when we have to build an induction regimen, there will be a steroid, there will be either an IMID or an alkylating agent and a proteasome inhibitor. We are also including antibodies in those patients who can afford it. This is off label right now, but in many centers abroad for high risk patients, we're trying to see whether addition of these antibodies is going to further improve the patient's survival, especially the high risk patients. So three drug regimens where we give steroid, an IMID or an alkylating agent, a proteasome inhibitor, plus or minus daratumumab. This is usually the structure based on which we give treatment to patients with newly diagnosed multiple myeloma. So is a triple drug regimen better than a double drug? And this is the SWOG OS777 study, which where they compared 6 months of VRD to 6 months of lenalidomide dexamethasone. So a double drug versus a single drug regimen and a triple drug regimen. And then all patients were put on maintenance in both the arms with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. So in this study, it was clear that there was using a triple drug regimen, we saw improved progression-free survival and median overall survival also. So based on this, right now, triple drug regimens are preferred over double drug regimens, both for transplant eligible and transplant ineligible patients, because we want them to have a fast, good response. Now, can we do better than an RVD, a bortezomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone? Is there anything we can do to improve this? So there were many studies in the phase two, which said that if we gave carfilzomib, then we were seeing better response rates. So carfilzomib dexamethasone seemed to have better response rates compared to bortezomib dexamethasone. So this is a randomized study where we are looking at the triple drug regimen of KRD versus VRD to see if it's going to be of any further benefit. So the patients in this study, if you look at the induction, the inclusion features, none of them had any high risk features or plasma cell leukemia. So this is very important. These are all mainly patients who had standard risk multiple myeloma, and the endurance study, when they compared VRD to KRD, followed by an maintenance of lenalidomide, we found that there was no difference in the response rates and even the progression-free survival. So in fact, if we looked at older patients, VRD seems to be numerically better than the KRD regimen. And so this for standard risk patients, because there is no improvement in progression-free survival or overall survival in KRD versus VRD, as of now for standard risk patients with newly diagnosed myeloma, there is no advantage of adding carfilzomib. There will be only increased risk of cardiac, pulmonary or renal toxicity, especially in older patients. So VRD remains the standard of care for patients with standard risk myeloma. So addition of the new proteasome inhibitor did not give any advantage, unfortunately. Now coming to the next question of when we are giving our regimen with the steroid and the proteasome inhibitor, do we add an IMID or a cyclophosphamide? And cyclophosphamide based regimens are more common in the UK and Europe world, whereas in IMIDs are more used in the US. Now, this is one study where they compared bortezomib thalidomide dexamethasone to bortezomib cyclophosphamide dexamethasone. And again, the response rates were better in the thalidomide arm compared to the VCT arm. There was a difference in the toxicity profile, with more patients having neutropenia in the cyclophosphamide arm and no more patients expectedly having neuropathy in the thalidomide arm. But the response rates were definitely better in the thal arm compared to the cyclophosphamide. More recently, in this 4-day study where they again had a KCD with carfilzomib with cyclophosphamide compared to carfilzomib with lenalidomide, again here the response rates were better in the lenalidomide arm compared to the cyclophosphamide arm. So I think that when we look at the role of cyclophosphamide, it appears right now that IMIDs seem to be more active compared to cyclophosphamide when we are using them in the triple drug regimen. So that is something to keep in mind. Next is, what is the role of antibodies in newly diagnosed multiple myeloma? So again, in the phase 2 studies, we found that including daratumumab in the regimen seemed to be improving response rates. So this is a trial where we saw a transplant ineligible patients, where the standard of care, like we discussed before, was BMP in many patients, bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone. Did the addition of daratumumab make any difference to these patients? So there was an addition of daratumumab followed by dara maintenance, whereas the BMP arm, there was no further maintenance. And here, the overall response rates in the dara BMP arm increased, the number of stringent CRs was increased, and the MRD negative rate also, once we add a monoclonal antibody, there is a threefold higher MRD negative rate in the dara VMP arm. Coming to the progression-free survival, again, at the 42-month point, we are seeing an improvement in the PFS from 14% to 48%. So definitely a regimen to think about in patients where we don't want to take them for transplant. This is another study, the phase 3 study for transplant ineligible patients. Here looking at the other regimen which was commonly used, that is the RD regimen from the first trial, and adding daratumumab to it. And once again, there is an improvement in the progression-free survival with 33.8 months in the lenalidomide arm and not reached in the arm which had dara. So improved responses, more stringent responses, more MRD negative rates, and improved progression-free survival. So patients with antibodies seem to be having better response rates. Even in the patients with high-risk cytogenetics, patients, when we are giving them daratumumab, there seems to be a greater improvement. This is a trial where they looked at an all-oral regimen with an antibody, which is called, with ixazomib, which is a PI, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone compared to placebo. And this actually did not reach a progression-free survival endpoint, even though the response rates actually were slightly better. And the numerically, the PFS numbers were better in these patients. So those patients in the Western world where they want an all oral regimen, older patients, this is something to think about. So what we are seeing, or the trend that we are seeing, is that as the regimens are improving, where we, the VMP regimen, we are seeing a progression-free survival in the 18 to 20 months. With the IMIDs, it is increasing to the 20 to 30 months. And when we are adding a proteasome inhibitor, further improvement. And when we are adding antibody, there seems to be a much more improvement in progression-free survival. So for even for patients who are not eligible for transplant, depending on their general condition and the reason for their ineligibility, we do have a chance with the newer medications to be a little more aggressive and move to three drug regimens like RVD or RVD light, and two regimens that will include antibodies. This is the RVD light regimen, where instead of giving it day 1, day 4, day 8, 11 or weekly, we are actually doing it, so we are giving the bortezomib weekly and a lower dose of lenalidomide. And then after 9 cycles, we are changing the bortezomib to alternate weeks. And here also, this is very well tolerated and the progression-free survival of 35 months. So you can play with the drugs a little bit and still get a good response for these patients. How about adding an antibody in transplant-eligible patients? And these were two studies, again, in this side of the Atlantic, where VTD was a standard regimen, adding daratumumab to VTD and in induction followed by a transplant, and the same as consolidation followed by Dara monotherapy. And the other arm was VTD and observation. And we can see that once again, when we are adding the Dara, we are seeing better response rates, deeper responses, and an improvement in progression-free survival. The overall survival data is still immature, but definitely there is a good improvement in progression-free survival. Similarly, the Griffin study done in US, where to RVD regimen, again in the induction we added Dara, transplant, consolidation, again DRVD, followed by maintenance, which had daratumumab and lenalidomide. So in this study, again, deeper responses, the depth of response was more, the duration of response was longer, and that slowly we are beginning to see an improvement in the progression-free survival, even though there is not much change in the overall survival. It's too early. But if you look at the MRD negative rate, again, the MRD negativity is really jumping when we are giving the daratumumab to these patients. So from 7.8% to 37.5%. And the sustained MRD negativity, so this is now the late what they are looking at, because it has been shown in some of the trials that if you have a sustained MRD negativity, these are the patients who really do well over a prolonged period of time. So here again, sustaining the MRD negativity is much more in patients where you're adding the monoclonal antibody. So definitely food for thought that when you are adding a monoclonal antibody to the RVD regimen or a VTD regimen, you are seeing deeper responses, more sustained responses, and improvement in progression-free survival. So what is the best induction regimen? Do we just stick with the standard RVD regimen or do we move to anything else? So these, important to remember that these regimens have not been compared to each other. They've all been compared to these double drug regimens or to very standard arms, but the better arms, the so-called better arms, have not been compared to each other. So there is no single standard of care, and different experts will use different things based on their preference and the patient's preference. Some things to remember, definitely three drug is better than two drug. In standard risk patients who are transplant ineligible, there does not seem to be any benefit of carfilzomib over bortezomib, and it is only the side effect profile that will make us choose one over the other. IMID regimens seem to be more superior to cyclophosphamide regimens, but in our country they might be cheaper, so we should not completely throw away the cyclophosphamide regimens. In standard risk, so RVD remains the regimen of choice. In patients, when we are adding Dara, as I said, there is an increased depth of response, improved MRDs, improved progression-free survival, but this comes at increased costs. So as of now, we can't say that this is the standard of care, but definitely in patients who are at high risk, who have high-risk myeloma, it is a regimen to think about. And we could even think about adding it to patients who have an inadequate response to RVD. So with all these regimens that are there, what do the NCCN guidelines say? So for transplant patients, like I said, RVD still remains the standard. We could still do CyBorD or VCD. And the other regimens are recommended, but category 2B is ixazomib. The Dara-Len bortezomib dexamethasone is also a recommended regimen. KRD is a recommended regimen. even for non-transplant patients, RVD, we can do DRD regimen like we discussed, or just RD if the patient is having is frail or elderly. So all these are recommended regimens in NCCN, and it's mainly based on the patient's preference, the cost factors that we will be choosing these. What about the role of transplant in multiple myeloma? It is not curative. That is important to remember when we are talking to our patients. What transplant does is improves progression-free survival. It also improves overall survival. There are many questions regarding transplant. We talked about one, which is the optimal chemotherapy regimen pre-transplant. Is there any role of giving consolidation treatment, more chemotherapy after transplant? What is the type of maintenance that we give, and what is the duration of maintenance? So when we do transplant, the autologous stem cell transplant for multiple myeloma, we do an induction, and like we discussed, a standard risk or a high risk induction, followed by stem cell collection. Here, depending on the center, in our center, we are using GCSF, and if we are not getting enough stem cells, we are then moving to addition of plerixafor. There are some places where they give right away cyclophosphamide and GCSF for better stem cell collection. Again, in the West, when they have a good amount of stem cell collection, most patients, they are cryopreserving for a second transplant when the patient relapses. Here, because we don't have standardized cryopreservation and it's also very expensive, we have only one chance at doing the transplant for most of our patients. So we do the stem cell collection for that particular transplant. So induction, stem cell collection, followed by the conditioning regimen of melphalan, and then the stem cell transplantation. Usually patient is in the bone marrow unit for about 2 to 3 weeks until the neutrophil and platelet recovery occur. Do we really have to do transplant for all our patients when we are seeing such good MRD rates with the addition of DARA, when we are seeing such good response rates with the RVD and carfilzomib regimens? So what is the benefit of early transplant? Definitely in our country, since we cannot store stem cells, it is better to go for an early transplant. But from a scientific point of view, early transplantation results in deeper responses and improved progression-free survival. We have to look at the patient preference, the age of the patient. Say a patient is of a borderline age where he is 70, 71. You don't want to be doing a transplant 3-4 years later when he relapses, but give a transplant upfront. Higher risk patients would probably benefit more from an earlier transplant. You also have to see how they've responded to the regimen and what are the resources, like I discussed, for long-term storage. So this is the transplant study, the IFM 2009, which was recently updated in ASH 2020. And this is the transplant regimen where they used newer drugs. So here, patients who were 65 years of age or younger, first line, they received RVD. And then this transplant versus no transplant, followed by len maintenance. So the patients were randomized into transplant versus no transplant. And what did we find? We found one thing was, in this study, the delay transplant was allowed at the time of relapse, and 79% of the patients underwent a delay transplant at the time of progression. So many patients did require a transplant later on, and those patients who didn't undergo a transplant, it was usually because of a rapid disease progression or a refractory disease. So what did we find? So it's in fact something like an early versus a deferred transplant. And here, complete response rates in the early transplant were more compared to those patients who got only the RVD regimen. Progression-free survival was also higher in the transplant arm, and overall survival, there was not a difference. So there is, you can discuss differing a transplant in standard risk patients maybe, but you have to remember that we need to have the ability to store the stem cells. If not, it might become a problem later on, especially if you're keeping the patients on a len maintenance for a prolonged period of time. In the updated analysis, what we found was of this study was that the MRD negativity was more for patients who received transplant compared to the arm where they had RVD alone. And this is important because we are now realizing that the higher the MRD negativity, the more patients who have MRD negativity, they have better outcomes. So in this graph, you can see that even though the patients with MRD negativity did better than the MRD positive patients, even here there is a separation between the arms where the MRD negative transplant patients seem to be doing better than the MRD negative RVD arm patients. So definitely there seems to be a role for an earlier transplant even today in spite of the newer medications that we have. What about maintenance post-transplant? Since all patients relapse post-transplant, it makes sense to have a maintenance regimen. For standard risk patients, we do a lenalidomide maintenance because that has been shown in many studies and meta-analysis to improve both the progression-free survival and overall survival. So lenalidomide maintenance is given to almost all the patients after transplant. The duration is controversial, at least 2 years of therapy right now, because there are some risks of prolonged use of lenalidomide, like second cancer rates. Also, about 30% of the patients discontinue lenalidomide because of the side effects. So can we stop after 2 years? Can we give only 1 year of lenalidomide? These are areas of active research. In high-risk patients, we instead of lenalidomide, we do a PI-based maintenance. It's usually bortezomib every 2 weeks. Sometimes we give bortezomib. In addition, we add lenalidomide. There are no trials comparing bortezomib to len maintenance, but if it's a high-risk patient, usually we give bortezomib as the maintenance. We should not forget regimens that are relevant to our country. Melphalan is a good, very good drug, which can keep disease under control for a fair period of time. So especially the cheaper regimens, melphalan, prednisone, thalidomide does not cost much to the patients. So having a melphalan, prednisone backbone and adding these drugs makes sense. BAD, which is no longer used in many places, but again, it might be an effective regimen. Dexamethasone pulses in some patients. So these are regimens which are kind of forgotten, but we should keep them in mind. So this is the algorithm in up to date for newly diagnosed myelomas. So just to summarize, we diagnose the myeloma, we will risk stratify them. If it's a standard risk patient and they're eligible for transplant, we will give RVD chemotherapy for and then discuss early versus a delayed transplant. If the patient is not fit for transplant and it's a frail patient, then you can think about RVD light or only RD or adding Dara RD. If it's a patient with a high risk myeloma, definitely a VRD regimen. You can also think about adding a monoclonal antibody, even though that is not a standard of care, followed by a transplantation and then proteasome inhibitor based maintenance. If the patient is high risk myeloma and not eligible, then VRD or KRD, or you can give patients again Dara based regimens. Now we all know that once the patient is diagnosed with myeloma, in spite of the best induction regimens that we have currently and a transplant, most of these patients do relapse. There are some groups of patients who have primary refractory myeloma where they never achieve a response. There are patients who will achieve a response and then within 60 days they will progress. This is the refractory group. And then the more common group is the patients who will respond initially, then after a period of time they will relapse. So there is a different definition for each of these, which is quite intuitive. So we have the primary refractory myeloma, the refractory myelomas, relapsed and relapsed and refractory myeloma. How do we decide on treatment once the disease relapses? One thing important to know is the duration in which they have been in response. And if there is less than 12 months of time from the first line therapy, these patients, no matter what risk stratification they were before, do become high risk. If the patients were high risk initially, but they have been fine for a long period of time, more than 2 years, these patients, we can think about them as standard risk patients. But the time to first progression greater than 12 months has a great prognostic significance. Patients who are refractory to treatment, the more treatments that they get, again intuitively, the lesser their median survival. So patients who are who are double refractory, meaning they're refractory only to IMiDs and proteasome inhibitors, the median survival that we are seeing right now is 11.2 months. Coming to the last group, which is penta refractory, where they're refractory to the proteasome inhibitors, the daratumumab, pomalidomide, lenalidomide, carfilzomib, bortezomib, all five of these drugs, the median survival here is only around 5.6 months. And this is where the role of these novel agents that we will talk about becomes more and more important. So when we have so many drugs, how do we decide? So do we treat every patient who relapse? Not necessarily. So patients need to have either a clinical relapse. If they have a biochemical relapse, we need to show that this is a very fast biochemical relapse where there is a doubling of M protein over 2 to 3 months or an increase in the free light chain ratio or free light chain of more than 20 grams per deciliter in 2 consecutive measurements. So we all see in our clinic a group of patients where there will be a mild increase in the M protein, but they really don't need a treatment as such. So we can wait and watch in some patients, but definitely if there is the CRAB criteria being fulfilled, then these patients need to be treated. And if the doubling time is fast, then they also need to be treated. So we now, in the relapse, it becomes much, much more complicated on how we treat the patients. We have to look at the patient factors. We have to look at what the disease and the morbidity because of the disease, what are the risk factors, the disease risk factor that is there. And most important, other than the patient factor, is the treatment history that the patient has had. What is the treatment that he had before? And again, if stem cell transplant is still a very much a valid option in these patients, and in the first relapse, again, we usually use a combination of these three groups, steroid, IMiDs, proteasome inhibitors, plus or minus the antibodies. So the first step is to once again see, is this patient eligible for stem cell transplant? If they've had a durable benefit of more than 2 years, definitely think about doing another stem cell transplant for these patients, especially if they have cryopreserved cells available. If they are not eligible for stem cell transplant, then the questions that we have to ask in our mind is, what are the drugs that this patient is sensitive to? Are they sensitive to proteasome inhibitors? Is this a patient who just received the initial 16 weeks of bortezomib and is doing fine only on len maintenance? Is this a patient where we finished giving a VRD regimen, did not give any maintenance, and they've been off therapy for maybe a year or so? Is this a patient who's on low doses of lenalidomide maintenance? So these are all the questions we have to ask. Basically, what we're asking in our mind is, what is it? What are the drugs this patient is sensitive to? Even in the relapsed setting, when we look at the multiple trials that have been done where they've looked at 2 drug regimens versus 3 drug regimens, it looks like triple drug regimens are working much better. So even here in the relapsed setting, we still have to think about 3 drug combinations for these patients, especially in the first relapse. We incorporate at least 2 new agents, and like I said, wait and watch and simpler regimens we always have to think about in a certain group of patients. This time we will continue the treatment until disease progression. We might decrease it from a 3-drug to a 2-drug regimen after we get a good response. If we start with a 3, incorporate at least two new drugs, and then continue it until progression, decrease intensity based on the disease response. So patients who are sensitive to lenalidomide, these patients, we do what is called a lenalidomide backbone, where you can continue the lenalidomide and dexamethasone, but to that you add the 3rd drug. And these are some studies that were done where the addition of a 3rd drug, it could be carfilzomib, it could be a monoclonal antibody, daratumumab or elotuzumab or ixazomib. Whichever 3rd drug that we added, there was an improvement in the response rates, in the very good response rates also, partial responses, and an improvement in progression-free survival in all these drugs. now all these regimens. And again, once again, when we add a monoclonal antibody, we are seeing much better responses. So this is the Pollock study where patients, in spite of having a relapse, the 30% of the patients achieved MRD negativity after adding the DARA. And there was an improvement in the median progression-free survival from 17.5 months to 44 months. So again, we have to remember that when patients in these studies, so we can't do direct study-to-study comparisons, because in each study, things are a little different. The patient inclusion criteria have to be looked at very carefully when we are looking at relapsed studies. So we have to look at the number of high-risk patients in each study. We have to look at whether they were only len refractory, or they were also carfilzomib refractory or bortezomib refractory. What is the risk stratification of these patients? A lot of things have to be looked at. So carfilzomib and ixazomib studies, which were there, they excluded both PI and lenalidomide refractory patients. So these were actually a very sensitive group of patients. Daratumab and elotuzumab studies excluded only len refractory patients. PI refractory patients could be there. Now, this RD backbone might be a difficulty in the current era, because many of our patients are on len maintenance, both the transplant eligible and the transplant ineligible patients. So these patients might not have been eligible for any of these studies. So when we are giving three drug regimen with lenalidomide on patients who have already been on this low dose lenalidomide, we have to take the results of these studies with a pinch of salt. There are the PI backbone studies where we can have three drug regimens added to bortezomib dexamethasone or carfilzomib dexamethasone. And here we have a pomalidomide bortezomib dexamethasone, again showing better response rates and improvement in progression-free survival. Pomalidomide dexamethasone backbone also, especially for patients who have progressed on bortezomib and lenalidomide, we can definitely think about a pom-dex backbone for these patients. So this is the Icaria study where they looked at isatuximab pom-dex, again good improvement and response rates. Here you can see that 94% of the patients were len refractory, 77% were PI refractory, so 72% of the patients were double refractory. Similarly, DARA POMDEX, this is the Apollo study. Again, a lot of patients who were double refractory, 68% of the patients were double refractory. And here also there was improvement in progression-free survival. This is the Eloquent 3 study where they looked at elotuzumab antibody and improvement again in progression-free survival. There is some retrospective data where patients who are refractory even to pomalidomide or to daratumumab, when you give both in combination, you give the DARA POMDEX, again we are seeing responses. So definitely we can overcome resistance to individual agents by giving combinations. So when we see the patient with a relapsed myeloma, we have to think, what is the backbone that we are going to add to this patient? What are the drugs the patient is sensitive to? And then plan our regimen. Also, again, in our setting, don't forget cyclophosphamide. We can always have a cyclophosphamide dexamethasone backbone and add these other drugs. So this we have discussed. So first relapse, we see if they're refractory to len, then we can use a monoclonal or we can use KRD. If they're not refractory to men, we can use a RD backbone and either add carfilzomib or bortezomib or daratumab. If they're refractory to len, then we change our backbone to either a POMDEX backbone or to a proteasome dexamethasone backbone. So we have to choose our regimens and keep deciding. So this is one way of doing third line therapy also. So once patients are on len maintenance, for second line, like we discussed, we can do DARA POMDEX, we can do DARA PI DEX, we can do bortezomib POMDEX. And when they progress on this, we can rotate and use the drugs that have not been used before. And cyclophosphamide is something that is common here in the third line. because we wouldn't have used them in the first and second line. If you had used cyclophosphamide in the second line, you can always use a Pomdex backbone in the third line. So what are the things that we can conclude from this? One is that if a patient is resistant to carfilzomib, they are usually resistant to bortezomib and ixazomib. So don't plan a regimen where after carfilzomib resistance, again, we are giving bortezomib. If a patient is resistant to pomalidomide, they will usually be resistant to lenalidomide also, but not the other way around. Okay. Whether DARA resistance is equal to ESA resistance, that we don't know yet. An important thing to remember is that now that patients are living for a long period of time and we are moving from one combination to the other combination to the other, there might be patients where we have not used one particular class of agents for a long period of time. And it might be that drug-sensitive subclones might once again emerge. So you can always think about re-challenging a patient with an older regimen when you are running out of options. And we are able to buy time and stabilize the disease for a few more months for these patients. Eventually, even with these backbones, patients do relapse, and that's where we talk about the triple refractory patients, patients who are refractory to an IMiD, a proteasome inhibitor, and an antibody. The pentarefractory, where they're refractory to both the IMiDs, both the proteasome inhibitors, and to DARA. And it is becoming very challenging to treat these patients. And here we have some novel therapies. One is venetoclax. This is the Bellini study where venetoclax was combined with bortezomib dexamethasone. Venetoclax, as you know, is a BCL2 inhibitor. And we do see an expression of BCL2 in patients with myeloma. And here, there was an improvement in progression-free survival when we added venetoclax to the bortezomib dexa arm. But interestingly, the overall survival was actually worse in this VEN-BD arm. And it was a patients. However, if you looked at the subgroup of patients who had the 11-14 translocation, these patients, the median overall survival not reached in both arms, and the progression-free survival was much better in the venetoclax arm. So I think that right now venetoclax will be studied mainly in patients who have the 11-14 translocation and again in combination. So the future studies will look at VEN-DARA-DEX or in patients who don't have 11-14, maybe adding DARA and VEL-DEX to these patients. So again, novel combinations, and venetoclax is important in myeloma because it will help those patients who have the 11-14 translocation. This is another drug called selinexor, which is an XPO inhibitor. XPO is a molecule that prevents the tumor, that causes tumor suppressor gene to leave the nucleus. And by inhibiting this molecule, we can have more tumor suppressor gene and suppress the myeloma. So here in patients who have been exposed to all these penta drugs and are triple class refractory, when we gave the combination of selinexor and dexamethasone to patients, there was a decent response rate of almost 26% in these patients and a progression-free survival of 3.7 months. A lot of patients had nausea and hyponatremia, and so they're figuring out how to use these drugs more safely for these patients. But definitely it is something that is another drug that is present. Here now, selinexor combinations. This was just a single agent with dexamethasone, but now we are looking at the combination. This is the Boston study where they looked at selinexor with bortezomib dexa, and again, improvement in progression-free survival. And there are a lot of additions to selinexor and a lot of different combinations that are being looked at. So one more option for patients who are refractory to multiple drugs in myeloma. Menflufen is an alkylating agent where there is this influx, where this drug is introduced into the cell. So it is a direct cytotoxic cell. And also again, in patients who are refractory to multiple drugs, we are still seeing a response rate close to 30% in these patients. Last but not the least, this is the most active target right now in myeloma patients. This is the antigen which is called BCMA, which is present specifically on patients with plasma cells, on the plasma cells and the myeloma cells, sparing all the other cells and tissues. So hopefully a safer treatment. And because there is a high specificity to the myeloma cells, we can use this as a good target. So how are we targeting the BCMA? By using antibody drug conjugates linked to the BCMA protein, that is belantamab mafodotin, which is FDA approved. We now have what are called bispecific T cell engagers, similar to what we see in ALL patients where we are using them. So these BiTE drugs, and then the CAR T cell therapy, all of them mainly targeting the BCMA antigen. So in the CAR T cell, there are different constructs of T cells that are being used. These are the studies, the KARMA study, which used BB2121, that is the ESA cell, and the CARTITUDE, which used the J&J molecule, EVOLVE, which used ORBACELL. All these studies in extremely refractory patients. You can see how many patients were triple refractory here. And in spite of that, we are seeing that these drugs are efficacious with good response rates, very high response rates. Overall response rates are in the 80% for the J&J molecule. Here it's about 40%. So high response rates, some MRDs also in these patients. So CAR T cell is something that is to stay and will probably be used in earlier lines of therapy. Main problem with CAR T cell is the cytokine release syndrome and neurotoxic syndrome. And as centers get more and more experienced in treating with CAR T, I think the side effects will be coming down. The BiTE also, we have three molecules, none of them FDA approved, but showing a lot of promise. And hopefully in the next 1 to 2 years, these drugs will also be available. This is the DREAM2 trial looking at the belantamab mafodotin. And again, these are patients who had multiple regimens treated in the past and seeing good response rates in these patients. So these are the three types of anti-BCMA therapies. Probably the bispecifics and the ADCs are what we are looking at, which can be used easily in the community. It doesn't take time. We don't have to specially prepare it for that particular patient in the lab. And side effects are also more manageable. So to conclude, relapse refractory myeloma is not a barren land anymore. In spite of progression on all these drugs, we still have some novel unique drugs that are coming out and showing a lot of promise for patients. Last, so that's where I will end and open to questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Study trial slides, which I can't see now, on some complications that we commonly see in myeloma, and we can always discuss that, but mainly one is hypercalcemia. And patients who are present with hypercalcemia, we should know how to manage them. Hydration is very important. Bisphosphonates, those who have renal insufficiency, we have to reduce the dose of bisphosphonates for these patients. Maybe denosumab might also be something that we can give to these patients. So hypercalcemia is one. Second is patients who present with renal insufficiency. So when we have patients who present with renal insufficiency, we have to think about how best to treat them. Lenalidomide cannot be given there. We usually give a more aggressive regimen where we will be giving bortezomib instead of weekly. We give it day 1, day 4, day 8, day 11. We will be giving steroid pulses for these patients so that we get a quick response. So, and we can also do dialysis. Maybe some patients need 1 or 2 dialysis before their creatinine will settle down. So, and also adding cyclophosphamide. So usually we give 1 to 2 cycles of VTD or VCD, Cybord D for these patients, and then move them to the RVD regimen and transplant. So if we are very smart at the time of renal insufficiency and jump to treatment and give the right kind of treatment, we are able to get most of these patients out of the renal insufficiency and still make them transplant ineligible. So hypercalcemia was one, renal insufficiency, bone issues, lot of skeletal related events that patients have, bone pain, fractures, Some patients need fixation of the bone. All patients who have bone involvement need to be on a bisphosphonate. I don't think there is much more benefit from denosumab compared to a zoledronic acid, but definitely patients who cannot tolerate zoledronic acid, we can give them denosumab. Patients with renal insufficiency also, we can think about denosumab. Lastly, when we are giving these drug combinations, infections can also be a problem. So whenever we give the RVD regimen, for all the patients, we usually give them Bactrim or levofloxacin. We will be giving them antiviral prophylaxis with acyclovir or valacyclovir. Whenever we are using bortezomib, we have to give acyclovir or valacyclovir. Whenever we are using an imid dexamethasone for patients, we have to give some kind of protection from thrombosis. So for low-risk patients who don't have other risk factors, we give them only aspirin. But if there are other risk factors that are present, history of a stroke or an MI in the past, we have to think about giving low molecular weight heparin also for these patients. All patients have to be vaccinated for influenza and for pneumococcal, yearly influenza vaccine and pneumococcal vaccine also. So hypercalcemia, renal failure, infections, thrombosis, neuropathy, anemias, we need to know how to manage all these conditions, especially in the beginning when the patients come in the first 4 months, all this become critical. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. It was an elaborate discussion. And Dr. Richu is asking any role of CAR T cell therapy. I think you already covered that, ma'am. And ma'am, am I audible?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so CAR T cell therapy, I think we are now giving it in the almost like a last resort for patients who have progressed on everything, but they're planning to move them to an earlier on setting. In India, it's not available, so we'll have to send our patients abroad for it. But I think more the other BCMA therapies are something that might come to our country once they're approved by FDA, and we might have more access to those, at least for the affordable patients.
Okay, ma'am. And ma'am, like in Indian scenario, you also talked about the drugs that can be used. So like, as we see, many patients cannot afford the transplantation. So even if, as you already said, that transplantation does not improve the overall survival. So can you just tell, in short, what should be the general algorithm for management for like patients who cannot afford? What should we start with, and like that, if they are not going to be
transplanted? The goal of induction therapy remains the same, whether you are eligible for transplant or not eligible for transplant. You want to get a fast response, you want to get a good response, and you want to have a durable response. These are the three things that are important, especially because patients come with a lot of complications at the time of diagnosis. So in our setting, I think if they can afford, I think RVD is still the best regimen to give. If they are less affordable, then cyclophosphamide dexamethasone with bortezomib is a good regimen. If they can't even afford, if they can't afford bortezomib, then we can still go to melphalan, prednisone, thalidomide is a good regimen. Thalidomide, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone is a good regimen. So based on the affordability, my first preference would still be RVD. If they can't do RVD, it would be CyBorD, that is bortezomib with cyclophosphamide dexa. If bortezomib is, or bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone too. Now, if bortezomib is out of the picture because they can't afford it, then we have to think about even dual therapies with just Lendex, Taldex, or we can do even melphalan, prednisone, thalidomide is also a good regimen. That would probably come in around 4,000 rupees per month. Dexa pulses also, while they're say looking around for money, just Dexa pulses also help.
So ma'am, can we just give melphalan and prednisolone? Yes.
Only melphalan, this. Prednisolone also we can give. There will be some patients where you can maintain them on melphalan, prednisone for a year. But now these patients, you cannot think of survivals of 3 years, 4 years and all that. Usually methylprednisone will work for 6 months, 9 months. In that slower group of patients, maybe a little longer, but probably standard risk. But you won't be able to pull them for too long.
Okay, ma'am. And ma'am, can you just please tell little about how to evaluate the minimal residual disease, the MRD you were
talking about? So the abroad, what they are doing is you can evaluate for MRD either by flow cytometry using the 8 or the next generation flow is what they're calling. So I think these are like 8 color or 12 color flows. So that is one way of doing it. And the second is by next gen sequencing. With next gen sequencing for MRD, you need to have a baseline. So when the patient comes at the time of diagnosis itself, we should have sent the sample for next gen sequencing and then follow up for MRD. For patients where we are using flow, you don't need to have a baseline also sample, you can still use it. So MRD testing is usually either by flow or by next gen sequencing. The questions are when to do the MRD testing and do we change therapy based on the MRD results. From what I can gather, one thing we can say is if you are MRD negative, then you are going to be a long-term survivor. So you will have a prolonged disease-free interval if you are in the MRD negative group. In the past, as in 2 years ago also, the thought was that if you achieved MRD negativity, that was enough. But now it appears that sustained MRD negativity is more important than just being MRD negative at one time point. So those patients who sustain their MRD for up to a year, so you do one sample now and then you do a sample after 1 year, and those patients who have the sustained MRD, these are the actual beneficiaries of whatever regimen that they got and will have a prolonged disease-free interval. So still MRD negativity is probably not a cure with the flow, and the NGS 10 to the power of minus 6 is what 1 in 10 to the power of 6 cells is what we are able to find out. There might be newer techniques that we will have to get to see if we can really cure patients. But the deeper the MRD, the more sustained it is, those are the patients who do better. How do we achieve the deep MRD, and is that, can that be a surrogate endpoint for trials, is what is of active research right now. So instead of waiting for overall survival improvement, because there are so many treatment options available, overall survival might not be a good marker in myeloma patients anymore. And if we want to see even progression-free survival, in standard risk patients, you have to wait so many years to see an improvement in progression-free survival. Can we use MRD instead is something that is that they're talking a lot about. And I think in the next 1-2 years, we'll be hearing much more about it. The trials that they're doing now are very interesting, where they are tailoring therapy based on the MRD responses. Where, what kind of treatment you give next, based on whether you're MRD positive or negative, is what they're looking at.
So ma'am, like after every cycle of chemotherapy, like how frequently should be done?
So in the trials, what they've done is the first MRD test is done pre-transplant. After the completion of those 16 weeks of RVD or DARA-RD, whatever regimen that you're giving, or DARA-RVD regimen that you give, so after the completion of that, at the end of the induction regimen is when you're testing for the MRD. The next MRD is done usually after the transplant is over. So after the completion of transplant is the second MRD that is done. And the third MRD is usually done a year after that to look at the sustained MRD. So these are the three time points that they are looking at right now.
And ma'am, is it a bone marrow sample or a serum? Like what? Where do we see that?
Bone marrow.
Okay.
As of now. Yeah. And there's one question on levofloxacin. I use Bactrim for all my, for most of the patients. So patients who are on RVD regimen, they will be getting aspirin, Bactrim, and acyclovir. We can use levofloxacin also. Bactrim, some patients do have Bactrim DS, they will have some side effects because it's a sulfa drug. some renal toxicities also can be there. So we have to look at that, but either one can be done.
Okay. Are there any other questions? So, ma'am, thank you so much. It was indeed very useful and very much informative session, and it increased our knowledge very much. And
thank you very much.
And thank you so much, ma'am, for spending your precious time. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.